meet Jesus when he comes, and striving for us to be made ready as well. We're going to start with, you'll very much recognize this first song.
You call him.
Found in Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 19, and it goes like this. These six things the Lord hates. Yes, seven are an abomination to him. Number one, a proud look. Ellen White says that there is nothing so offensive to God or so dangerous to the human soul as pride and self-sufficiency. She says this in Christ Object Lessons. And as we studied this morning, as we in Sabbath school, that was King Nebuchadnezzar's problem, which is why God had to deal with him so severely. Number two, a lying tongue. Number three, hands that shed innocent blood. Number four, a heart that devises wicked plans. Number five, feet that are swift in running to evil. Number six, a false witness who speaks lies. And number seven, the number that the Bible uses to represent completion, one who sows discord among brethren. Quite often, pride is the foundation of all of the sins on this list, which is why it's listed as number one. But the reason that the sin of discord was listed as number seven, the reason that God has a complete hatred for the sin of sowing discord, is because discord was the result of what Lucifer did in heaven. Lucifer, in his pride, exulting in his own beauty, coveted Christ's position, and endeavoring to gain homage to himself, spread lies about God throughout the angels, many of whom believed in him, and the result was discord. Lucifer's pride led to discord. Lucifer did not make an immediate transition from Lucifer to Satan. It was a process. Ellen White says in Patriarchs and Prophets that little by little, Lucifer began to indulge the desire for self-exaltation. In other words, the process that led to the condition of our world today began with a single prideful thought cherished in Lucifer's mind. And that is a very serious warning to us to be constantly aware of the direction our thoughts are headed. And not to dismiss any prideful thought we experience as though it does not matter. And this is what is expressed in this next song.
He who is broken Thank you.
when Satan put forth accusations, false accusations about God, not only to the angelic hosts, but also as he has been doing with humanity over the course of thousands of years, God's response to these accusations, the way that he proved Satan's accusations false, was to send Jesus to this earth. Amen. From his birth in the manger to his death on the cross, he lived a life of humility and hardship. However, his disciples, for pretty much all of his ministry on this earth, did not learn that lesson, did not comprehend that lesson. Even his mother Mary did not understand his mission, because their view of what the Messiah would do, that he would conquer the Romans and elevate the nation of Israel to an exalted position, their misunderstanding of Christ's true mission was a result of their pride, which led them to interpret the scriptures incorrectly. The Pharisees in particular passing this on to the nation of Israel. And so the disciples were not immune to this pride. They had grown up with this mindset, and therefore they were not prepared for Christ's mission when he was arrested and crucified. But it was through being arrested and crucified, the disciples, in their brokenness, began to be humbled. And Peter, when he did what he never dreamed he would do, denying Christ, came face to face with himself and was also humbled. Even Mary at the cross and the agony of experiencing her son's death, the last thing she ever dreamed would happen. And it was through this humility that Jesus was finally able to say to Peter, "Feed my lambs, feed my sheep." It was only when all of the disciples were humbled, coming to God in humility, humbling themselves before one another, before God, that they were truly ready to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and proclaiming the gospel to the world and eventually even accepting Gentiles. They had to experience that humility first. But when you think of the painful life of Mary and what she did not understand, we know that when she discovered Christ's true mission, as painful as it was, it worked a transformation in her as well. Because when you read at the beginning of the book of Acts and the people that were gathered in that upper room, Mary was there. We don't know, the Bible doesn't say what happened to her when the Holy Spirit was poured out, but we know that Mary was there. And obviously God used her in a mighty way. But what the disciples and Mary had to learn, what all of God's people have to learn, what the Jewish leaders at the time had to learn, is the parallel to what we have to learn before Christ's second coming. That it is only when we experience brokenness and humility and humble ourselves before God and one another, that we, like the disciples, will be ready to do the work that God calls us to do.
One day walk on water, Mary. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men."
Amen. Amen.
Mentioned we've been doing what we're doing right now for over 30 years. And when we went into full-time ministry, we didn't know what it was going to look like. We were mentored by Herman and Sonny Harp, and they helped us, particularly Herman helped us a lot through the first several years in the road, all about motorhomes and traveling and going from church to church and different things like that. Stephanie also mentioned that we've had a few breaks now and then. The last was during COVID. But due to Lonnie Melashenko from the Voice of Prophecy and some friends, they got together when they found out they were really in a predicament with the home we were renting in Arizona was being put up for sale, and we had 30 days to move. We didn't know where we were going to go. And they put together a fundraiser, Lonnie and his friends, to purchase the motorhome way about here. And all of a sudden, you know, during COVID, we didn't know what was going to happen next. We didn't know if the churches would be open like this ever again. And if they were, what would ministry look like? And if the churches were open, would anybody show up? Because maybe they'd just stay home and do Zoom and live stream, which a lot of people do, and that's a great thing. But we didn't know what it looked like for us. But all of a sudden, we find ourselves back in the road. We were asked to go to 3ABN and do some recording before we even had the motorhome. And I asked the pastor earlier if I could leave on the foyer out there some things about Streams of Light International, and you can pick those things up. And we did, Stephanie and I were asked to record, or to write, and to record the theme song for them, which we did before we even had a motorhome. And my wife told the person who asked us to do this, God willing, we'll have a motorhome, we'll be at 3 a.m. We got there in the morning, about 3 hours before the recording, never having rehearsed the song, because we didn't have a keyboard, didn't even really have a place to go. And we recorded it within a few hours, it was aired that live, and all of a sudden we looked around and go, wow, we're back in full-time ministry. We don't even have a concert. We had nothing was booked. And we have been busy since. We've traveled around the country many times. We're glad we're back in Southern California here. We're here for the next several weeks. We are dependent upon the support of the churches and camp meetings and different various organizations that we travel to 365 days a year to keep us on the road. So at this time, I would like to ask that a free will offering be taken to support Dawn of Hope Ministry. And if you'd like to make out a check, please make that out to Dawn, D-A-W-N, Dawn of Hope Ministry. We are a 501c3 nonprofit, so if you'd like to receive, you can supply that as well. And while that has been done, we will continue with some more music. And thank you so much for your support. Amen.
Truly taught us to love her.
The idea of humbling myself before God and allowing Him to search my heart was not a concept that I embraced for a long time. I saw conviction of sin as something scary, and so I wanted nothing to do with it. But you know, one thing I've learned about God is that we serve a very patient God.
Amen.
And He was very patient with me, but there came a point where He knew I had to grow in my spiritual experience. I plunged into a severe emotional breakdown, had recurring thoughts of ending my life, and became acutely aware of the lack that I had in my Christian experience. I was listening to someone share their testimony on Christian radio and knew that I was not experiencing what this person experienced. So finally, in desperation, breaking down, weeping before God, I finally asked Him to reveal Himself to me, even if it meant being convicted of sin. And so finally, God was able to do the work that He wanted to do. I finally gave Him that permission. And so when I did that and continued in my walk with God, I discovered something. I discovered that conviction of sin isn't the scary thing I thought it was. I have come to the point now where I appreciate it when God shines His light into my heart, not only revealing the things that should not be there, but also revealing to me why they are there. What happened in my past? What have I been feeling? What led to me being in the condition that I was in? You know, there are many wonderful counselors in the world, but there's no counselor like Jesus.
Amen.
He's the only one who could read the heart and help us to understand ourselves in a way we never have before. But when God convicts us of sin, He doesn't stop there. He knows that in and of ourselves, we are incapable of repenting. So He gives us what I have experienced in my life, one of those most precious gifts, the gift of repentance, where I weep not because I'm beating myself over the head with self-condemning guilt, but because I'm experiencing godly sorrow for how I have hurt Him and hurt others. And there is something incredibly healing that takes place when this experience occurs and you are able to release things that are trapped inside and work through them. But even then, God does not stop there. He then gives us the gift of pardon. He heals our wounded hearts. He sets us free from the sins that enslave them. And so, I would like to, before we do our last song, based on what I have just described to you, and I'll tell you that before this experience, I saw God as my friend, but now after going through this experience, I now see Him as my Father.
Amen.
This experience that I thought would be frightening actually drew me closer to God. So I want to encourage you, if you are experiencing trials or coming face to face with the sinful parts of yourself, remember what Jesus said, for every tree that bears fruit, He, meaning the Father, prunes it so that it will bear more fruit. What you're experiencing is a sign that you're growing. And the closer you come to God, the more you will see your imperfections. That's supposed to happen because it's how we grow in our relationship with Christ. When Jesus warns us of our spiritual condition, He does not leave us in hopeless despair. He does not expect us to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. The Laodicean message is a message of warning, but it's also a message of hope, because God never warns His people of their spiritual condition without supplying the remedy.
Amen.
So if you are feeling weak, helpless, powerless, out of control, then you are at the perfect place for God to do a mighty work in your life. And when you come to Him in your greatest weakness, He will provide His greatest strength. So as we do this last song, it is my prayer that you will seek God privately in your own hearts and allow Him to search your hearts for anything that should not be there, that through the power of your Holy Spirit you may repent and lay it down through the power of the Holy Spirit. And even though that process is painful at times, you will find yourself closer to God than you ever have been before. And when we humble ourselves before God and before one another, He's calling us to do that as well, putting aside any differences that may exist between us, as the disciples did before the day of Pentecost. We will be ready to receive the latter rain, to proclaim the three angels' messages, to give the loud cry, and finally go home. A sign shall be given, a virgin will conceive, a human baby bearing undiminished deity. The glory of the nations, a light for all to see, and hope for all who will embrace His warm reality.
Amen.
Father in heaven, we do thank you, Father, that you are with us through Jesus, through Emmanuel. Father, we want so much to be closer and closer to you, Father, even if that process is difficult. We know it's worth it in the end. And so, Father, I pray that each of us will place ourselves in your hands, for we are the clay and you are the potter. And do a mighty work in our hearts that only you can do, that we may experience revival and reformation individually and as the body of Christ in these last days. That we may move forward in doing the work you have called us to do, bringing many into your kingdom. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I hope you have a wonderful Sabbath day, and God bless.
Amen. Thank you.
How many want to say thank you to Stephanie, God, and Mary? Thank you so much. Definitely blessed. Definitely blessed. We're going to invite you to just stand. We're just going to have the benediction, and with that, we'll go. Now, somebody did ask if you have CDs and tapes. Oh, okay. Oh, give your email address, you provide free. Ooh, that works. Excellent, excellent. All right. Remember, we have a fellowship luncheon, and you are all invited to that. So we hope that you come. Thank you for being here. Now receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace that comes through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who humbled himself, became a babe, so that we could have life through his name. In his name we pray it, and all the people said,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, one and all.